Hello, good evening and welcome to this webinar. I'm Faruque Ghanchi, one of the consultant ophthalmologists based here in Bradford in West Yorkshire, England. We got a fantastic lineup of speakers for this webinar based on experience that we have with COVID-19 pandemic and its impact on our clinical practice in ophthalmology. This webinar is put together with the help of Alimeria Sciences and Heidelberg Engineering. It's dependent on the internet, so from time to time, if you experience any interruptions, please bear with us. As the internet connection gets better, you will connect back to us. We would like to have your feedback at the end of the webinar. Please complete the feedback forms. And we would also like you to have your questions ready and keep on asking the questions throughout the webinar. From my point of view, I'm really delighted to be here and have been supported by this fantastic faculty that we have. As we have quickly learned, COVID-19 is highly contagious and with high morbidity that it is affecting all of us in our clinical practice, something that we did not expect or experience before. Along with that, the measures that various governments had put in to tackle with the pandemic itself, such as social distancing and lockdown, is impacting how we provide the clinical care to our patients, not just the ophthalmology patients, but the patients presenting in our hospitals with other conditions, including infections with COVID-19. And this has got a big impact on health, physical and mental health, as well as we are realizing now, on the social and financial health as well of the population at large. So what we need to do quickly is to learn that we are dealing with patients who have lots of sight-threatening conditions, and some of them may quickly become life-changing if they're not attended to. In our clinical practice, we have patients coming to our clinics, and we have the examination set up for these patients where the patients are in close proximity to the assessors. So we have to think about the protection equipment that the clinicians and supporting staff would need to have access to. Furthermore, we have experienced disruption to the provision of clinical care, both in regards to the lockdown, where we have regard to the public health in reducing the spread of infection to our patients and public at large. At the same time, we have to understand the anxieties our patients would be facing of the fear of losing further vision or suffering harm to their general health through contamination to infection that they can catch with COVID-19. So quickly, we have to come up with plans how we tackle with this situation. And one of the best ways to deal with that would be the risk stratification for our conditions that we deal with. And we have to prioritize the services that we have been providing for our patients, like the ocular emergencies, certain conditions that require prompt attention, such as patients with macular degenerations, retinal detachments, some patients with uveitis and the like. So we have to come up with the plans for service innovation in how we deliver our services differently, how we transform them in time to make sure that we reduce the risk to our patients of further vision loss. Once we go through this phase of acute infection and things start returning back to normal, we need to start thinking about how we're going to plan our services after the COVID-19 pandemic is easing off a little bit. So we, as I said, we have a fantastic lineup of speakers. And our first speaker is Mr. William Tucker. He's a bright future for our ophthalmology specialty in ophthalmology in UK. He's a consultant ophthalmologist at Moorfields, and he has led to come together with a plan in how to deal with this COVID pandemic and a range of our clinical services, starting to collaborate with his colleagues at Moorfields, and then on a bigger scale with the colleagues nationally in UK. So I'll pass it on to Mr. William Tucker from Moorfields for his talk about the experience and arranging services in ophthalmology. Thank you.
Many thanks, Faruque. I'm just going to advance the slides. So as Faruque says, I'm a consultant ophthalmologist in Moorfields, and I took on the divisional director role at Moorfields about 6 months ago, little realizing that I would be jumping straight into the fire, trying to deal with the COVID pandemic. My colleague Konstantinos is going to talk to us a little bit later about Moorfields' specific response to the COVID pandemic, but I just want to go through some of the Royal College guidance and guidelines about how we as ophthalmologists should be managing during this pandemic. So we're just going to focus over the next 10, 15 minutes on a few things from the Royal College and bring in guidance from others as well. The key principles really for what we've had to do during this pandemic are around protecting patients and protecting ourselves. We've had to make difficult decisions about who should be receiving essential eye care, who should be prioritized. We've had to innovate and work out ways to review these patients safely. We have in ophthalmology been involved in these PPE nightmares and discussions that are ongoing. And all throughout, we've had to try and maintain as high a quality care as we can. I'm discussing the Royal College response, I'm not actually a kind of executive member of the Royal College. And so these are my opinions, and you shouldn't take them as read from the Royal College of Ophthalmology. So protecting patients and staff. So really, from the second week of March onwards, perhaps before, if you were very prescient, it became obvious that there's going to be a need for a rapid application of advice and new guidance to protect the patients and staff. I feel actually ophthalmology has taken a lead on this, and I think we had to, and there are a few reasons why we had to. As has become apparent, we actually look after the pretty much the highest risk patient groups for COVID-19 disease. We now know, which we didn't necessarily know at the beginning, that really diabetics, patients with cardiovascular risk, I mean, in particular, older patients are those at the highest risk, perhaps, of dying from this disease. As an example, which we worked out for our response to this, we now know that 95% of injection patients attending the retinal therapy unit at Moorfields for AMD are over the age of 70. So that's 95% of our patients who were told very early on in this pandemic that they were at high risk of dying from COVID-19. There was also a perceived high risk around some of our immunosuppressed patients, obviously in uveitis and cornea and adnexal. Interestingly, the perception around the amount of risk they're under has gone down more recently, but certainly at the beginning, we had to start making rapid plans for how we would protect our patients that we had started on this immunosuppression. What we knew from quite early on was that coronavirus is present in ocular fluids, and actually conjunctivitis is a potential early sign of the disease. And we also knew tragically that ophthalmologists and eye healthcare workers were potentially dying of this disease early on. As we know, Dr. Wen Liang died in early February in Wuhan in China. And he was one of the first, as an ophthalmologist, he was one of the first people to recognize this disease and this pandemic was occurring. So Moorfields has managed to take a step forward early on in this disease, partly for the reasons that we're an independent trust. Therefore, our CEO sits on the crisis panel for London, which meant that he very quickly got an idea of how bad this situation was able to see modelling. And that meant that we could immediately start planning ophthalmology services and risk stratification instead of having to wait for that information to filter down through NHS bureaucracy and a larger trust. It also, we also have the advantage at Moorfields of Melhin Guarani sitting on the college panels, and actually she was able to then move our guidance and help straight onto the RCO website. This is the link on the screen for all of the different resources that are available on the RCOphth website at the moment. There's currently 40 and growing rapidly, but we're just going to focus on really the key ones. So for the most key document right now is from the college about the management of ophthalmology services during this pandemic, most recently updated on the 28th of March. The key phrases from it are that all routine ophthalmic surgery should be postponed, and all face-to-face outpatient activity that isn't for patients who are high risk should also be postponed, but that we should continue doing A&E services. It's important to note that even though the college is based in London and things started going wrong in London very early on, this guidance applies to everybody, to every eye unit in the country that falls under the Royal College purview. So quite reasonably, people might ask, well, why, you know, in our small town, there's no COVID that we know of, and everybody's wearing PPE now. This is a London problem, isn't it? And I think, again, what has become apparent is the risk of this particular disease around asymptomatic carriers and the ability to transmit it long before you get symptoms. We think the rate's now something around 40%, and patients have a week of being infectious prior to their symptoms. And it's not just the patient's journey within the eye clinic that we need to worry about. You know, we can wear PPE, we can put the patients in a mask, and we can feel confident that within the eye clinic environment, we can control things. But getting to the eye clinic is potentially where these patients could be receiving their dose of coronavirus from public transport, from their own families transporting them, friends transporting them. And that's one of the reasons, other reasons we need to try and reduce our patient load in clinic. So prioritizing patients, you know, this has been some of the most difficult decisions that really our generation, not just in ophthalmology, but in all specialities, have had to face. As we know, some chemotherapy patients haven't had chemotherapy for the last 6 to 7 weeks. We took this as a chance for us to take an initial lead, and that led to the risk stratification document you'll see on the next page. The basic principles, of course, are prioritizing into high risk patients, those who essentially will lose either their sight or their life if you don't continue reviewing them in clinic, medium risk patients who might be able to offer other alternative ways of reviewing them, perhaps remotely, and low risk patients who frankly can just be deferred for 4 to 6 months. And also then in the background, there's this worry about setting something up different for immunosuppressed patients or those who should be shielding. It's important those decisions, unlike previously, perhaps when clinics have been cancelled down, were made by senior clinicians or consultants, but then communicated quickly to the admin teams. So one of my initial roles within this whole pandemic was to try and distill the large amount of information coming from the different subspecialities and more fields into a single document, which led to this document here, the Moorfields Ophthalmological Risk Stratification and Implementation Guidance. It grew just from risk stratification into implementation because what was basically happening was that the clinicians were happy with how it looked, but then our admin teams were very worried. It didn't tell them how to actually move patients or when to move them or where to move them to. And so we added the implementation columns that you can see on here. Medical retina is going to be gone through by my colleague Konstantinos later on, but I just wanted to show you, if you haven't seen it already, this is available on the college website. My main contribution to this, apart from collating the information, was colouring everything in bright colours. The only one that didn't get a bright colour for me was genetics, because unfortunately I wasn't a fan of genetics. However, I felt quite guilty about making it grey, and later came back and changed it to a nicer teal colour. This was the risk stratification document that went on to the college website very early on in March, and remains there now, and has been the basis for a lot of units to adapt and use for their own purposes, I think. Okay, so reviewing the patients, how can we do it safely? How can we manage the clinic journey? Of course, the safest review for any patient at the moment is one that involves them staying at home. But if they have to come into work, how do you try and make things safe? Well, first, plan for your own workforce, protect your at-risk staff, those who are immunosuppressed. Organize yourselves into hot and cold rotas so that staff don't have to work too long at any one time. Provide first and second tier cover for sickness and make sure you're maintaining staff morale and well-being. When you're booking, well, before you even book the patients in the first place, you should risk stratify them, as we've discussed. Provide lots of information from the hospital, from your own eye clinics, and provide information on getting in contact with you, but either by emails and helplines and expanding their use. Working with optometry primary care services is a hot topic at the moment, and that's something that we'll be doing more of over the coming months. When you book the patients physically into the clinic, consider booking them into these remote consultations, telephone or video consultations, where you can just get away with posting medication to them. It's important to check their intention to attend the appointment before they actually the appointment date. However, despite that, patient's still DNA. Review the risk factors and symptoms for COVID-19 at that point, but also check them again when they arrive in clinic. We're doing temperature checks and masking all of our patients and visitors at Moorfields. I know that's not done universally. Aim for 2 meters physical distancing in clinic. That is not necessarily achievable in all cases and is actually quite hard to achieve. If you go and measure the gaps between the untaped off seats in the Moorfields waiting area, it will not be 2 meters apart. However, we're aiming for physical distancing where possible. And of course, having isolation rooms ready for patients who attend with sight-threatening disease, but also have potential coronavirus and COVID-19 symptoms. And then during the clinic, try and reduce patient journey times. That means minimizing investigations that you might normally do for them, minimizing face-to-face time, because of course that's the at-risk period for transmission of coronavirus when people are talking to each other. That might include taking a history by phone from a different room, and also more consultant review instead of junior doctor review, partly because, as cool as that is, it may mean the patient only needs to be seen once instead of twice. And then, of course, and I think we're doing this already, is when you come up with your treatment plan or your management plan for when they need to be reviewed again, be aware of the fact that it may need to last for 2 months, 3 months before you can realistically see them again. So PPE, goodness me, PPE is a controversial topic. It's the advice changed pretty much daily during the first few weeks of the pandemic. We've settled now into this rough guideline for PPE. The important things to note are that very early on, we came up with the idea of a slit lamp breath guard, and that was rapidly spread around the country via the clinical leads group and via the college website. Something I think we can all be pleased with. We all know about the difficulties with PPE at the moment. And I think in an ideal situation, we'd be using more PPE than is suggested on this, more protective PPE than is suggested on this chart. However, we have to be cognizant of the fact that our colleagues are potentially going into, medical colleagues are potentially going into very high risk situations daily. And if we use up the PPE that should be going to them, then we're putting them at risk as well. PPE is a controversial subject. The college has distilled this guidance from the Public Health England guidance. And as of right now, there's no new updates on this, apart from the fact, as we know, that people might start considering washing gowns, which hopefully we won't have to do in ophthalmology. So I'm just going to finish up really talking about how can we maintain high quality care. We now have some time available. We should be increasing the amount of information given to patients, colleagues, other groups, our optometry colleagues. We can become more accessible via remote routes to everyone, really, offer a second opinions to our primary eye care services, collaborate with each other, offer second opinions freely to other eye units around you. And as Faruque has mentioned, it's time to start thinking about reworking models of care, service transformation that could become permanent post-COVID. Some examples, the helplines that have been set up, the ability to post medication, obviously remote consultations may be here to stay, And now's the time to push for all those IT and EMR upgrades. Just finally, I want to finish by saying a few statements, really. I think the world has changed, if you didn't already realize. The NHS has changed. Ophthalmology in the UK has changed, and you yourself may have changed your priorities or health. We have become more responsive in ophthalmology in the UK. We've become more responsible thinking about public health. And I've been really impressed with our ability to collaborate rapidly to protect ourselves and our patients. We've got to continue to be resilient at the moment, because over the coming weeks and months, some complacency or bureaucracy is going to try and pull back all these advances we've made, and we must continue to strive. It's a bit of a wishy-washy statement, but really it can't be more true that these are the defining days of our careers and lives, so we must use them wisely. But do take a moment to check on yourself, your friends, and your colleagues. And that's my final statement. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bill. A brilliant talk, and what a way to finish with those statements that you just made. That brings us to our next panelist, Helen Davenport. She's a colleague of mine here at Bradford, and she's lead for the macula service as well as the uveitis service. I'm sure many of you know her as a regular panelist on lots of national and international meetings. And I would pass on to Helen for talk about how the pandemic and services have been affected here in Bradford, the Bradford experience. Over to you, Helen.
Thank you very much, Faruque. Thank you for the introduction, and thank you to Heidelberg and Alimeria for inviting me to speak on the webcast this evening. Will's given us a fantastic overview and insight into the problems and some of the solutions that COVID-19 has presented to us in ophthalmology and in the wider NHS. So I'm going to hone down and be a little more specific about how things have affected us in Bradford. So my personal experience. So we've had to make a lot of adjustments to our practice, and the main aims of adjusting practice have been primarily to minimise the spread of virus whilst trying to prevent avoidable blindness, at the same time reassuring our patients and staff who have been quite anxious about the risk of developing the virus versus the risk of loss of vision for our patients. But also to ensure that we have robust communication channels at this time, which have proved to be very effective. I'll start with communication. I think that's been one of the biggest changes that we saw very early on in the response to the changes that we've had to make due to the pandemic in Bradford. So from very early on in this, we started to have a departmental daily huddle. Huddle really is a bit of a misnomer. With social distancing, it's really not possible to huddle. However, the whole of the clinical team would get together, standing 2 meters apart in what was the waiting area of our outpatients. There'd be representatives from our management team, from the secretarial support team, and from our clinical admin team. Those colleagues who were at home because they may be self-isolating and working from home, and those colleagues who were at remote hospital sites and were able to dial in because we used the Zoom system in order to communicate. We used these daily meetings, which are still continuing, to cascade information quite quickly from the gold and silver command within our trust. So to cascade information down, but also for those of us on the ground, on the coalface, to be able to convey issues and problems that we might be experiencing up the chain through the bronze, silver and gold command of the trust. We also at these daily huddles would ensure that we had the essential cover in place for our emergency eye clinics, for taking telephone calls, and to ensure that we knew who was on call, who was covering what, and basically we had a plan for that day and for the following day. And of course, things were changing very, very quickly, particularly at the beginning of this crisis. And so having this daily huddle was really, really useful. We also have shared Outlook calendars, which we started off very early on. So it was clear which members of staff within the department, clinical staff that is, so consultants, optometrists, juniors, were on leave, who were self-isolating. So therefore, who'd be available for any other roles that we may be asked to do within the trust. So in order to minimise the spread of the virus, Will's already gone through a lot of the changes that we've had to make to our practice, but these are the specific things that we have done in Bradford. So we review all of our clinics in advance. So that's the consultants and optometrists who work in our clinics and make clinical decisions on a regular basis, making the decisions about really who needs to be seen and who doesn't. So who needs a face-to-face consultation and whom it would be appropriate to do a telephone consultation with. And that's all to do with the risk stratification that Will's already alluded to and explained. Our secretaries would contact our patients so that patients knew whether or not they were going to need to attend, and if so, what time they needed to attend, or whether they would be receiving a telephone consultation. In order to minimise the spread of the virus for patients attending and for staff attending to the patients, patients would be screened over the telephone when they were invited to attend for their clinic appointment to make sure that they didn't have any symptoms suggestive of COVID infection. They were advised to attend alone where possible, but if they needed help to get to the clinic, it was asked that relatives or carers would stay in the cars outside the hospital. We were asked that patients arrived on time and didn't come early, so we didn't have overcrowded waiting areas. We moved the seats in the outpatient waiting room to 2 meters apart to ensure social distancing. We are only doing imaging, so OPTOS or OCTs, if it was going to change the management, or in cases where it would replace the need for a slit lamp examination and therefore more prolonged contact, close contact with the patient. We obviously had the PPE for clinicians and nursing staff in line with the NHS England recommendations. Again, Will's already covered that, so I won't go into that in any detail. We followed the guidelines, and again, early on, we had the slit lamp screens or breath shields fitted. We instigated the use of eye protection, so visors attached to the masks for staff who were performing intravitreal injections. And we ensured that when patients were coming, their appointment times were staggered. And we used the Outlook calendar for this to ensure that whatever clinic patients were turning up for in the department, they would not all be arriving at the same time, again, to aid social distancing. So how do we go about this preventing avoidable blindness? Well, the risk stratification that Will referred to is what we have used, but we've also done a slightly more specific in detail recommendations through the Yorkshire Retina Society. So the Yorkshire Retina Society comprises of many of the consultant retinal and uveitis specialists across the Yorkshire region, including myself and Faruque Ghanchi, who's introduced us today. And we came up with some slightly more detailed guidelines. These are guidelines, they're not protocols, and as with any guidelines, they will vary very much depending upon the local circumstances, and the threshold values will vary depending upon the local circumstances. But an example, for example, in AMD, would be that we would continue to treat patients with injections if the eye being treated was their better eye, or if the eye that we're treating was above 70 EDTRS letters. If the eye that was being treated was less than 40 letters and not the better eye, we would consider delaying this patient's appointment. If the visual acuity was between 40 and 70 letters, then we would treat those patients who bring them in for an injection if the other eye was less than 70 letters. But if the other eye was better than 70 letters, then we felt that perhaps delaying their treatment was not going to be life-changing, and therefore we would telephone these patients rather than bring them in for an injection. Where patients were having bilateral treatments, we would consider treating both eyes at the same time. We do that anyway, but sometimes the eyes are separate, so one eye is needing to be treated at a considerably different interval to the other eye. We would put that to one side under these circumstances. And if a patient is going through the risks of attending, that we'll explain the travel to get there, etc., then we would treat both eyes at that one time. Patients who are telephoned are always given a contact number so that they can call us if they have worsening symptoms. On the day, if patients who are arriving for injections, so this is the AMD patients, we wouldn't necessarily do a visual acuity, OCT, or dilate the patients, trying to minimize the time that they spend in the department. Just to note here, I think the YRS guidelines, which are available on the Yorkshire Retina Society website, and I've given the link there above, if you wish to have a look, probably result in perhaps fewer patients attending for treatment than the RCOphth guidance. But again, you know, each patient is looked at as an individual and weighed up based on the risk of developing the virus versus the risk of to their vision. So there've been barriers to preventing avoidable blindness, which we perhaps didn't perceive when we set out and we're phoning these patients and inviting those that we felt were at risk of life-changing sight changes. There were quite a number of elderly patients who are isolating and were too afraid to attend. So despite us explaining that we were minimizing the contact whilst patients were in the department, we had staff wearing a suitable PPE, etc., a lot of patients still made the decision not to attend for fear of developing the infection. So also, we identified that there were patients who we felt it was appropriate for them to attend for their injections, but were unable to get there because they're patients who relied on hospital transport services and the hospital transport services were not available. Those patients who were happy to just book a taxi couldn't get hold of taxis either. So this has been a real problem, actually, in getting patients who are willing to attend, actually getting them to the clinics. And we also came across incidences where we had patients who were in nursing homes or care homes, where the homes were refusing to allow the patients to attend the clinic appointments because the homes, nursing homes or care homes, were on lockdown, so they weren't wanting patients to leave and potentially bring back the virus to their home. So I thought I'd just run through the key changes to the way we've been doing things and give a bit of a timeline. So from 4 weeks ago, as Will said, the directive was no routine theatre sessions for ophthalmology. So that was the first change. Our theatres were cancelled. About 3 weeks ago, over the last 3 weeks, we've been predominantly doing telephone consultations, apart from those patients who are at high risk. We've had significantly reduced numbers of patients coming through, including the AMD patients. And most of those AMD patients who have been attending have been attending for injection only. Research clinics moved to our research facility and out of our main outpatients. As of 2 weeks ago, our main outpatient department was closed. So that was at the main hospital, the Bradford Royal Infirmary, where all of our COVID positive inpatients are. And it was suggested by senior management that we closed all outpatient services on the main site and those services were moved to St. Luke's, the hospital the other side of the city. And our macular clinic happens to just be around 5 minutes away from the St. Luke's hospital and is a standalone unit. So moving our service here minimized risk to patients from being in the same hospital as the COVID patients. However, it significantly reduced our capacity, going down from approximately 15 rooms available to see patients face-to-face down to 5 rooms. As of 2 weeks ago, our trainees were all redeployed to the medical wards. So they underwent a couple of days of additional training. And since then, as consultants, we've been first on call, doing 24 hours on call. We have been managing the acute referral clinic or eye casualty. We've been having to cover for the trainees whose clinics were already booked. And of course, we've been covering for colleagues who may be at home self-isolating because of pre-existing health conditions. So although we've not seen many patients face to face, it's been an incredibly busy time. Just to continue with the key changes, Not only have we lost medical staff to the wards, but we have a significant reduction in our number of nurses to support our clinics, having gone down to reduced to 5 registered nurses and 2 healthcare assistants in our smaller unit, other staff having been redeployed to the wards. Our registered nurses have continued, those who were trained to do so, continue to do the intravitreal injections, but have also been helping out with the telephone consultations and telephone triage of patients. So the consultants, having reviewed their clinics, would make a clinical decision based on the history of that patient and recent imaging, would put that decision onto Medisoft, our electronic medical record system. And then that would enable nursing staff to assist with the phone calls. And then the patients would be called back by a clinician if there were any issues on that phone call. So our optometrists colleagues have been fantastic. They've really stepped up to the mark and been helping with the telephone consultations and decision making on reviewing the clinics prior to the actual clinic day, deciding on who needs to be face to face and who needs to be a telephone consultation. They've been helping out with the telephone consultations and have been helping out in our acute referral clinics as well. Our orthoptists have moved across to our unit and have been helping out doing things that perhaps would have previously been done by our healthcare assistants, so assisting with visions and scans. So it really has been a team effort, and the individual staff members have all been extremely flexible. So consultants and optoms, as I've said, have been covering for colleagues isolating. And at one point, actually, last week, as consultant ophthalmologists, I don't know whether this is perhaps slightly insulting, but I think we were wanted more for our brawn than our brains. And were asked at one point if we would be part of the teams who would assist with proning patients on ICU. Fortunately, they had large enough teams and we haven't needed to do that. So what about the aftermath? We're going to have a huge backlog of patients requiring outpatient follow-up appointments. There is, of course, the risk of potential harm due to delayed follow-up. Late presentations of disease we may be seeing. So patients' disease may well be more difficult to treat because patients have not attended due to fear of attending, or haven't been referred due to the lack of primary care eye services. In that, you know, most of our optometry practices are closed at present. Of course, there's that backlog of delayed surgical procedures. We're going to be competing for theatre time with other surgical specialties. And again, this is very much where that stratification of the risk of blindness is going to come into its own again. And we have that looming risk of a second peak necessitating further restrictions on our service provision. So we have to be ready at any time to move back to the position that we're in now once we start to move into the recovery phase. But to finish on a positive note, I think we've learned an awful lot from this. In particular, I think we've learned to communicate better as a department. Not only have we had more communication, we've had better communication. There's been more virtual meetings, meaning that everybody's available, everybody's able to chip in, and everybody has an understanding of what's going on every day from the 9 o'clock meeting. We've adapted to new ways of working, doing telephone consultations, use of photos and videos, patients sending in photos of their eyes to a dedicated line and videos too. And I think most of all, what we've really done is we've realised the power of the team. And that's been an extremely positive thing. So thank you very much. I'm sure there'll be some questions at the end. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alan. Very good talk again, and a timely reminder of the importance of communication and also of the potential of collateral damage of that we may see as a fallout from this pandemic. Can I just remind the audience that we would like to have questions as we go along throughout the webinar. You can write the questions on the panel on your right-hand side, and we would see them and put it to the panelists at the end of the talks. This brings us to our next speaker, Mr. Konstantinos Balaskas. He is a consultant ophthalmologist, a very good and dear friend who is working at Moorfields Eye Hospital, and he's a director of the reading center there at Moorfields. He's going to share with us the experience he has had at Moorfields and London in particular through this pandemic. Over to you, Konstantinos.
Thank you very much, Faruque, and to the organizers of the event for inviting me to contribute. I'll start by echoing Will's statement about it's difficult to overstate how unprecedented these times are and how things are changing drastically around us. Maybe sometimes it's difficult to realize it as we're locked down in our flats. And also from a behavioral science point of view, it's very interesting how quickly we adjust as human beings, as professionals, as healthcare systems. And evidence to that is all the brilliant work previously presented by Will and Heaven. I will focus in this presentation on the specific response that was put in place by the Medical Retina Service at Moorfields to address these unprecedented challenges generated by the COVID pandemic that, as mentioned previously, severely and disproportionately affects our patient population in medical retina, including the AMD and diabetic retinopathy patients. So the cornerstone of the approach that was put in place was risk stratification. These are the two words that have been mentioned a few times already in this webinar. And by that, we mean trying to identify which patients are at high risk of being adversely impacted in terms of their vision by changes in their care plans that had to be introduced in response to this crisis. As Will presented before, this risk stratification was introduced on a national level by the Royal College of Ophthalmologists, and then it was adjusted on a regional level by different eye departments, and Helen shared the work that has been done in Yorkshire around that. We are probably fortunate in medical retina that the vast majority of our patient population falls into the medium or low risk categories. But on the other hand, that will lead to a very significant increase in capacity pressures on the other side of this pandemic when we need to pick up care for the patients we are now deferring or canceling. I will present in slightly more detail the risk stratification that is relevant to medical retina. We make the distinction between new patients and follow-up patients. In the high-risk categories, we have a limited number of classes of patients in terms of new referrals. Essentially, they are the patients with proliferative diabetic retinopathy and choroidal neovascularization, as well as patients with central retinal vein occlusions. And in terms of follow-up patients, from the diabetic retinopathy population, we classify as high risk those that need panretinal photocoagulation or those who have just had it but still need to be monitored soon after the procedure to ensure that the response is adequate and to continue with the treatment if needed. We're also continuing to provide intravitreal injections for patients with wet AMD, but we have changed the way we assess these patients, and I will talk about that in a bit more detail later. In the medium risk category, this is essentially one specific type of patients, those with pre-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, both new patients referred into the service and follow-up patients. And these are those who we can defer, but we're a bit more cautious in terms of the review interval that we specify for the review. And then the bulk of the patients can be classified as low risk in medical retina, which, as I mentioned previously, will later have an impact on the recovery plans when we need to start repatriating these patients into our services. With these patients, in this risk stratification and the implementation plan that Will mentioned before, there is already embedded some provisions about picking up care of these patients when it is possible to do that safely. So these patients are deferred for 6 months in the vast majority of cases. But we are specifying whether once they can be seen again in our services, this will be done in a face-to-face clinic, as was the case before the pandemic, or whether it would be appropriate to review them in an imaging-based digital pathway, what we commonly also label as virtual clinics, which is a pathway that is already in place in Moorfields and in other eye departments in the UK. But such new ways of seeing patients and managing patients will increasingly be appropriate or useful to help us cope with capacity pressures after the pandemic. So specifically in terms of what has happened in Moorfields, so Moorfields, for the members of the audience who are not UK-based, provides services from a number of sites in London. There is a central hub and then a number of satellite units. Out of those, three had to close. But as part of the contingency planning for the response to the pandemic, there were scenarios where more sites could potentially close, and then all activity would be consolidated in the central hub. That was in case there will be a need for redeployment of large number of staff to support the response to the pandemic. Fortunately, these fears have not been realized up to now, at least, and we're still functioning from 7 sites in London. The next slide focuses on how the situation has affected access to care. So the number of referrals we are receiving for patients with AMD. In this graph, you'll see these three columns. They compare a period of 7 weeks, the last 7 weeks, between the 3 years, 2018, 2019, and 2020. And you'll see in the gray column, which corresponds to 2020, in the last 3 to 4 weeks, the number of referrals of new patients with suspicion of neovascular AMD has dropped very significantly. The question is, why is this happening? Are patients choosing not to attend because they prioritize life over vision? Does it have to do with the fact that many of the optometry practices in the UK have shut down? In the UK, primary care for ophthalmology is delivered through community optometry practices. This is the first point of call for patients who have any symptoms of potential neovascular AMD. And so this is the usual route of access to hospital-based care in the UK. And most of the optometry practices have shut down during this period. This also highlights what previously Will and Helen also mentioned, that we are probably facing or will be facing another pandemic after this one is over, a pandemic of neglected chronic disease, including late presentation of patients with neovascular AMD and the impact on patients that are already in our services. And we will need to find ways of coping with this situation after the pandemic. In terms of the patients already in our services and how this situation has affected them, in this slide, you will see the did not attend rates, so the number of patients who are not attending our services or are cancelling their appointments. And we're comparing here the same period of time between 2019 and 2020, and you'll see a dramatic increase in rates of non-attendance of our patients from 13% to 40% during the same period of this year. Again, it is unknown to what extent this will lead to irreversible vision loss for these patients that are not attending our services. And also whether many of these patients will need to go on intensified treatment regimens once we can resume their care. So for example, patients that are on longer retreatment intervals with neovascular AMD, who now are not able to attend, may need to go on more frequent treatment, more frequent injections, and thus will have a significant impact on our capacity. As Will also previously mentioned, the vast majority of our patients with neovascular AMD fall within the demographic that is at highest risk of serious illness if infected with COVID-19. And this is some of the data that informed our planning for reconfiguring our services in response to this pandemic. So 89% of our patients are over the age of 70. And so this information fed into some modeling work that was carried out to prepare our response and the reconfiguration of our services. And there were a number of scenarios that were examined, including doing nothing, so continuing with the injection service as was before the pandemic. And that would translate, as you can see here, into more than 11,000 appointments expected in the next 6 months and 2,000 injections. As opposed to what actually happened, on the right-hand side, it's the scenario that came to pass, and it's actually the situation now in Moorfields. So we revised the scheduling of these patients. We stopped doing vision checks and OCTs for them. Our routine practice up to that point was to do an OCT on every visit, every injection visit for our neovascular AMD patients. We stopped doing that. That was to try and have a better flow of patients through the service, a seamless flow, and minimize the time they need to spend in the hospital and stay in crowded waiting rooms. So to minimize the risk of infection for these patients. And because of that, we were not able anymore to assess how the disease is behaving and then adjust the retreatment intervals accordingly. And so the patients were kept on the, are now being kept on the latest retreatment interval. And we're following the algorithm you see in this table at the bottom of the slide. So for patients at the earlier stages of their treatment, we continue for weekly injections. But for patients on more extended intervals, we maintain them on those intervals, but we're not able to assess whether the disease remains stable or whether its activity is increasing, because we're not doing any assessments. And again, we will know after the pandemic, whether that has an impact on visual outcomes for our patients. As part of the contingency planning, there were even more severe scenarios that were examined. So worst case scenario that is presented in this slide would be if we had to reduce our activity even further. That could be, for example, if all activity needed to be centralized in one hub, or even worse, as was a fear, that all other eye departments in London might need to shut down because their medical staff would be redeployed to support the response to the COVID pandemic, and in which case almost all ophthalmology activity in London would be consolidated to the central hub in Moorfields. And to cope with such extreme pressures, one of the scenarios examined would be to only treat patients with bilateral disease, and in that case, treat the better seeing eye, or treat patients with unilateral disease where the fellow unaffected eye would have poor vision. And we're fortunate in Moorfields to have good databases to be able to inform this modeling. And so we could estimate the numbers of patients that we could potentially need to treat if we were to only treat patients with bilateral disease and then treat the better seeing eye, or patients with unilateral disease with a fellow eye with poor vision. And in this case, we would anticipate approximately 2,000 injections in a period of 6 months. That would, for example, allow us then to absorb activity from other sites in London, if that would be the case, if that would be needed. Now, finally, briefly, I will change theme and talk a little bit about the impact of the situation on research activity. So in my role, I'm leading the Reading Center in Moorfields, which is a research center focusing on ocular imaging. And in that respect, this situation has been very disruptive to all academic activity in Moorfields, but also in most other eye departments in the UK. Research activity has been suspended, and that includes recruitment of new patients to clinical trials, but also continuing to follow up patients already recruited in research projects. The overall infrastructure supporting research has been quite supportive and helpful. The HRA is the regulatory body in the UK that provides the framework for ethical and R&D approvals for research. And they were helpful in providing a framework for suspending research projects in a way that is not terribly onerous to staff in R&D departments. So we're just submitting an amendment to protocols indicating that the study needs to be suspended and the estimated period that the suspension will last. We're also fairly fortunate that the funders of our research have also been supportive and flexible, particularly the National Institute of Health Research, which is a major funder of research in the UK, will continue to finance research projects during the periods of suspension. Some types of research, however, are not affected, particularly data-related research and research on artificial intelligence, which is one of the areas of particular interest academic interest in more fields. However, other areas of research, such as industry-sponsored trials, are very severely affected. The recovery plans that Will and Helen briefly mentioned in their talks pertaining to the clinical services will also need to be considered for research activities. So we need to put in place recovery plans to resume research projects. And there will be challenges in terms of that, and particularly also in terms of initiating new research projects, particularly because our pathways for access to care may be very different after the pandemic. For example, the way patients access care, how they're referred to our services, may be very different. They may be referred through optometry practices in the community with less opportunity to interact with them and consider them for recruitment in clinical trials. And so we'll need to consider new ways of ensuring that we can continue with meaningful research that can bring about benefits to our patients. On the other hand, there will be great new opportunities for academic endeavors after after the pandemic. For example, on the front of modeling, the impact of the suspension of care, the disruption of care on visual outcomes. For me, it will be very interesting, for example, to see what impact will have the fact that all our patients with diabetic macular edema are not having injections for a period of 6 months. What impact will that have on the visual outcomes? What impact will there be from not doing OCTs on every visit for our neovascular AMD patients and maintaining them on fixed retreatment intervals? Would that affect the visual outcomes? And the response to that can inform how we manage our patients going forward. And also, there will be a greater emphasis on research around new models of care, digital technologies will help us cope with the capacity pressures after the pandemic, including teleophthalmology pathways, even home monitoring or artificial intelligence decision support systems. So this brings me to the end of my talk, I'm sure there might be questions after that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Konstantinos. That was very comprehensive and very informative, including the research aspect as well. Our next speaker is the only speaker that we have here from the continental Europe. Dr. Galileo Pinazzo from Valencia is going to share his experience working through this COVID pandemic in Spain. So without further ado, over to you, Roberto.
Thank you very much, Professor. It's my huge pleasure to share with you for the next 5 to 6 minutes the experience in Spain, all the clinical experience and impacts in ophthalmology that this pandemic is having in Spain. Thanks to Alimeria and Heidelberg Engineering for the kind invitation. So to put things in context, as you know, Spain's quarantine was announced on March 14th. Previously, medical education meetings were canceled by March 4th. Since then, no news about that. A lot of webinars, obviously, as you are aware. So by that time, 151 cases were confirmed, and among them, 13 corresponding to healthcare professionals. We have no specific recommendation for self-protection, whereas sports and leisure activities in the beginning of March were still on. This partially explains the problem that we are facing in Spain with this pandemic. And remember that UK is a week behind Spain, more or less, so that you can figure out what's going on. The first death reported to COVID infection in Spain was dated on February 13th, 1 month before the quarantine was announced. So since that date, March 14th, no specific measures were proposed in any public or private setting. And since then, progressively, very elegantly my previous speakers have presented, patients were confined at home. So in the public setting here in Spain, most residents and ophthalmologists were relocated to the specific COVID units created in the hospitals, with a significant lack of protective equipment and materials. All this time, assistance to patients has been limited to emergencies and very particular and few cases and situations. So today, we have over 30,000 healthcare professionals with COVID-positive infection, and over 30 physicians died. This is the terrible news from Spain. And now we're facing a new time where there is a plan to accept ordinary surgeries in ophthalmology beginning next week. We have been asked to include specific considerations about COVID in informed consents and daily clinics to our patients, and limiting the capacity of our waiting areas. So in between brackets, I think somehow ophthalmologists were used to really crowded waiting areas with patients waiting for hours at times. I think we are done with that. It's very unlikely that this will happen in the next months and probably years. So patients need to be rescheduled as well as surgeries accordingly to this new situation. I don't want to go into detail as my previous speakers did a very, very, very good job with this. So the question is, how will the public system in Spain be able to manage this crowded situation with a previous waiting list for cataract surgery, for example, of 105 days previous to this problem? Probably further cooperation with private settings will be mandatory to decrease this tremendous burden. And obviously all the staff members, not only physicians, need to wear masks, gloves, any available protective equipment. With all this, we have an uncertainty about how patients will feel and how we will face this new reality, for sure. We are considered heroes as physicians for some reason, but at this point, I think we should not be looking for heroes. We should be looking for good ideas, as this gentleman stated years ago. So in summary, we may never go back to normal. At times, it seems that we are waiting to be able to go back to normal. But we really need to rethink our position and options. Clinicians and patients should get used to these particular safety procedures that will be with us for a long, long time. In terms of intravitreal injections, in my personal opinion, they should be continued the more we can. In most cases, into a treat and extend regime. And one possibility, for example, is that physicians who do surgery do only that surgery with more days for this, decreasing the total volume of patients in a particular day of surgery. We have found extremely relevant to perform a pre-visit questionnaire for patients, accompanying persons or caregivers visiting our facilities, to make sure that they have no relevant symptom or history of COVID infection. So I wanted to be brief. This is all from my side at this point. I'm happy to answer any questions if there are any. And thanks again to Alimeria and Heidelberg for putting together this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Roberto. That was concise and very precise, sharing your experience from Spain very eye-opening. Thank you very much, all the panelists. We have quite a few questions, and if you're happy to answer those questions, I would like to put them in groups of subjects that questions have come across. One of them is around the teleconsultation. Do we follow any set structure for teleconsultations? Can I ask Helen to pick up on this, please?
Yes, certainly, Faruque. So I think that the first thing we do, which I think is crucial for everybody, is to identify that you have the right person on the end of the phone. We would have our MediSoft notes, so our electronic medical record system with all the patient's clinical records available in front of us. And I usually telephone the patient and ask them to confirm their date of birth and their address, first of all, to ensure that that we're speaking to the right person. Then essentially, obviously, it depends upon the condition for which you're following them up. Most of the patients that I've been doing my telephone consultations for have been uveitis patients or patients in the macular clinics. So if I pick out particularly the AMD patients, so those AMD patients who we deem at low risk of visual loss or life-changing visual loss, we would essentially ask them about whether or not they've noticed any deterioration in vision in the eye that we've been treating, or for example, if their other eye is their better eye, we would also ask them, have they noticed any change in that? We ensure that we have a possibility of bringing the patients in, should they say that they've had a marked deterioration in their vision in either eye. We also make sure that patients know that we are happy for them to phone us and that they know what telephone number to ring on, should they notice any deterioration if we make the decision not to bring them in for an injection.
Thank you. Robert, are you using teleconsultations in Spain?
This is a real problem in Spain. We didn't have a very well-prepared setting. Private insurance companies are really moving in this sense. Most of them have this possibility right now, mainly with phone calls, not imaging, not video consultations. But within the public system that, as you know, is majority here in Spain, the only thing that physicians are doing is call the patients they can reach, talk to them, and unfortunately, that's it. The situation with telemedicine in Spain is extremely bad.
Got it. Okay. So it brings me to the next question, which Robert alluded to some extent in the question, is the video consultation. A couple of questions on that. One specific about Attend Anywhere software. Can I come to you, Will, about this? Do you have any experience of using this video consultation software, number one, and where is it useful?
Some experience, yeah. Obviously, the Peter Thomas, our digital director at Moorfields, has championed Attend Anywhere. Is it useful in medical retina? So I'd say that's a difficult question. I think it basically probably serves the same function in medical retina as a telephone consultation. I think where it has proved very useful in Moorfields is in the adnexal service, unsurprisingly. Where they can visibly see the condition that's being described, and also in pediatrics as well, and to a certain extent, I think in some of the genetics clinics where they've wanted a reassuring face. However, you know, video consultations are a very great, useful thing to come out of the COVID pandemic. However, you know, for us, particularly in medical retina and presumably as well, you know, things like glaucoma, not necessarily the answer.
Can I contribute?
Please, Constant.
Thank you. On this point, the video consultation may not be ideally placed for medical retina, as Will mentioned as well. And it has other use cases where it might be much more useful. There were a couple of cases that Peter Thomas, the director of digital innovation in movies highlighted where it was possible to assess an OCT that was taken in an optometry practice in a patient with a suspicion of neovascular AMD. That was by setting the screen between the optometry practice and the A&E department in movies. They were able to review the OCT, but that's not obviously sustainable and scalable for a referral triaging process in the long term, or especially after the pandemic. So other solutions such as teleophthalmology solutions, mainly the store and forward model, where an OCT can be forwarded to a hospital-based service and can be reviewed at a different time by someone there, by an expert there, would be something that would be sustainable for medical retina. But there are other use cases in adnexal cell disease, as we mentioned, where video consultation would be more useful.
So our pediatric ophthalmologist consultant feels that it would be very useful in their settings for follow-up of strabismus patients, for example. Oculoplastics is also one of the specialties which lends itself quite well for video consultations. I'm aware of time, so I'm going to move on to the next batch of questions, which is about how you're going to cope with this work that is going to come to us once things return back to normality. One of the questions is, would you be putting on any extra clinics for, say, glaucoma or AMD patients? Can I ask Konstantinos first for your views on this, and then maybe Roberto in Spain?
Yes, thank you, Faruque. It will be a variety of approaches that need to be adopted to cope with the pressures that will inevitably come after the pandemic. Additional clinics might be an option, but there will be this will incentivize adoption of digitally enabled pathways. It will probably turbocharge our ability to introduce such pathways. And for example, that would include more virtual clinics. So accommodating these low and medium risk patients in imaging-based clinics, not necessarily requiring face-to-face review and consultation, but reviewing these patients on the basis of imaging. That would be quite suitable for most of the diabetic retinopathy patients, but also for patients with stable AMD after treatment, etc. These virtual pathways already exist in Moorfields and in many other places in the UK, but this is an opportunity to scale them up significantly now to cope with the pressures that we're going to face.
Roberto, do you have any comments to add?
I completely agree. In particular, I think that the most vulnerable patients when we talk about medical retina obviously are AMD patients because of the age and because of the threat for vision, significant vision loss. So my plans are to configure only neovascular AMD clinics twice every week ever since our quarantine here in Spain is released. Because as perfectly said previously, it's not only patients, but the relatives or caregivers who really don't want them to come to our clinics at this point. So we will be need an extra effort to cover their needs for treatment.
Sure. Thank you. Helen, this question is to you. Do you ask patients in Bradford to wear face masks?
Okay, that's an interesting question. It's something that we've been discussing at our huddles, and we have passed up to the silver and gold command within the trust. I think we decided that because of the potential lack of PPE, if we were to supply every patient with a mask, we would restrict it to procedures where there was a prolonged contact with the patient, or unless the patient was coughing or sneezing but didn't have any other symptoms of COVID-19. For example, with regard to a prolonged procedure, so if when we start to do PRP laser again, you're in prolonged contact very close to the patient's face. And for that sort of thing, we decided that it would probably be reasonable to use a face mask for the patient. We're still waiting to hear. I think, you know, there may be government guidelines on this with regard to the public wearing face masks out and about, and that may actually change our plan.
Thank you, Helen. Now, I'm going to move towards the last phase of the questions, which fall into the group of questions about the future services that we want to plan. Now, one of the questions here is quite interesting. What impact do the presenters think that the current reduced numbers in ophthalmic activity will have on the long-term effect in patients' quality of life and eye health? And this is to the panel. So do you want to take this up, Will?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've all discussed it at this point. I think the honest answer is we don't know what the impact is going to be, but there is going to be lots of research done to try and model that over the coming months. I think that we need to work really hard to collect the data that will allow us to predict that. I think there could be more lockdowns. Well, do I think there will be more lockdowns? Almost certainly in the UK and across other countries. And the ability to go into those lockdowns with more data about what will come for our patients will be most important. So I think it's very hard to quantify at this stage, but most important thing now, as we come out of these lockdowns, is we collect the data.
Okay, the other question was, in some trust, apparently, they want to open up sessions for stable glaucoma patients soon. Is it wise to start that way, or do you want to have risk stratification strategy again in opening up the services? Will, can I ask you about this? Because I know you're doing some work on this already.
Yeah, I think that I would certainly risk stratify again for the recovery period as well. I think there is an intrinsic risk to the country, to all countries, of widely opening up again, of having a second peak. Unfortunately, as we know from historic data, the second peak for the 1918 flu pandemic was worse than the initial one. And certainly there are models that the NHS has looked at which show a peak after opening up after a lockdown could be worse than what we're experiencing right now, which is quite scary. I think that we have to treat the recovery period, certainly in these first few months, in the same way that we treated the response, by stratifying our patients, by being realistic with other patients, with the low-risk patients about their care. They're going to be reading lots of news stories about cancer patients who aren't receiving care. So I don't think it's unreasonable to say to somebody with a stable glaucoma, you're going to have to wait even longer before we see you again, because literally patients are going to be dying out there because they haven't received care from other specialities. That's my personal opinion, I should add.
Thank you. Any other panel members want to have a comment on this?
No, I think Will's really put things into perspective there, which I think is really useful.
If I could add something, as Will said, it's difficult to predict, and it will depend, as I mentioned previously, our contingency plans had included a number of scenarios, so there are worst case scenarios and some not as catastrophic ones. So it will depend on the course of the pandemic and any additional waves that may occur and how that will impact our capacity to deliver care to low and medium risk patients. But the modeling work will be crucial to understand to begin with whether we were over treating or under treating certain patient populations, certainly with diabetic macular edema in the medical retina community. Has never been entirely clear whether it has been essential to treat as intensively as we have been. And so this is an opportunity for research that would not have been ethically acceptable previously. So stopping treatment for a number of months to see what the outcome will be on vision for our patients. But we will be able to have this data and collect this data, and this will inform largely our plans for the recovery period alongside the actual course of the pandemic.
Sure. I know the sponsors have been very kind for letting us extend the webinar for almost another half an hour. I'm aware of the delegates also being here with us all throughout. So thank you all very much. I think there was a last question that says, would ophthalmology services would be ever normal again? I think the short answer, myself, think that it probably won't be normal, but there would be a new normal. I think I would suggest to the sponsor that we consider having another webinar specifically about planning the services beyond COVID in the near future. I would like to thank each one of the panel members, the speakers, Will, Helen, Konstantinos, Robert, you've done an excellent job this evening. Thank you all the participants, the delegates, and the sponsors. Thank you for your help. Can I just remind the delegates once again to fill up the feedback form, give us your suggestions for future webinars that we can host for you. Thank you all once again. Have a pleasant evening. Goodbye.